Hi, I'm Luke Fevin, and I took a left at the valley.
I know we shouldn't have to scream that we're atheists. You know, we don't have non-astrologers and all that. But with the religious people taking over the world, I mean, we can either speak up or be pushed into a corner.
I'm proud to be an atheist, a skeptic, a non-believer, an infidel, a heathen. I call it how I see it. I say it's ignorance, and you just call it faith in unsubstantiated claims. That's something to be ashamed. I'm an atheist.
Coming at you from Secret Studio in BC, this is Left of the Valley. My name is Kevin, and I didn't say it was your fault. I just said I was blaming you. Joining me as usual is a team diplomatic enough to tell you to go to hell in such a way that you look forward to it.
We're all Slytherins here.
She thinks we don't need gun control, we need idiot control, Nancy.
Oh, man, there. Oh, yeah. Thumbs up on
support,
that one.
100% support Nancy for president.
Yeah, but what do I do if I'm the idiot in the room? Wait a minute.
He says money doesn't buy happiness, but crying is better with Dom Perignon, Scott.
Oh, yes. Yes, definitely.
Also, money can buy you puppies.
Well,
and puppies are the embodiment of happiness.
Oh,
she says to never hit a person with glasses, you as a baseball bat instead. Christina.
Especially if it has nails in it.
I have a trunk I can put the bodies in.
Yes. Two of them.
Yes.
We can have two bodies.
And she knows that the trick to not cry with onions is to not form an emotional bond with them. Kirsten.
I really need to start working on that one.
Yeah, Kirsten.
And she wrote a song about a tortilla. Actually, it's more of a rap. Annette.
Oh.
Yeah.
Lay down a beat for Annette. Guys, welcome back. Today we're going to have a very, very interesting show because we're going to be talking to the fantastic, the fabulous Nate Phelps.
Oh, I'm really looking forward
to that
interview.
Man extraordinary he is.
Absolutely.
But first, let's do a bit of chit-chat because, God, we got lots to cover this week.
Really? I think nothing happened this week.
Oh, I almost wish. Did you guys hear that Manson is dead?
Woohoo!
Yes.
Yeah.
Finally.
Dead at the age of 83, the cult leader that killed seven, well, he didn't kill himself, but because of him and his cult killed seven people in 1969.
Yep.
Nancy, why didn't you stop them?
Yeah, Nancy.
I would have stopped him if I could.
Well, she did capture him, by the way.
Yeah, that's right.
Did you guys hear that some finches on the Galapagos Islands are actually becoming a new species?
Ooh.
Yes.
I did read about that.
Yeah, they've been observed since 1981 when they noticed the arrival of a male of a large cactus finch that's not usually on the island, and he found a local medium ground finch female to mate with. Now apparently there's about 30 plus individuals, and they're starting to describe it as a new species because no interbreeding, and they're different enough to be called a new species.
That's so cool. Oh, but I thought evolution wasn't real, guys.
No, sorry.
No, God did it.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Well, you know how the creationists are going to react to that. I said, well, yeah, but it's still a bird.
Oh, my gosh. Give it a few million years and
exactly.
It might not be.
Exactly. That's pretty impressive. Since 1981, that's a very short span. Did you guys hear that apparently 300 theologians signed what they call the Boston Declaration, condemning the abuse of Christianity by the U.S. conservatives and the Republicans?
I saw that and I thought, good move, you guys. Mm-hmm. Really good move.
Yeah. Apparently some white Republican evangelism is in crisis according to these people, and it's a crisis of their own making. That kind of gives me hope. You know, they're actually trying to say, you know, we need to go back to Jesus and our faith, even though their faith is bullshit. But still, at least their message is positive.
Yeah.
I'm going to reserve any comment on that.
Well, actually, before that was in the news, I've heard a number, a very small number for sure, but a number of Christian ministers condemned the evangelical movement that is so prominent in the U.S. And I think what spurred a lot of this is Roy Moore and the brand of evangelicalism he has in Alabama, and how people are sticking with him regardless of the allegations of pedophilia.
Everybody grab your buckets.
And it's a matter of how can you be a person of faith and yet say that this is perfectly okay,
exactly.
and politically okay, and in the church it's okay. So I think that has perhaps started a movement, to at least make people much more aware that there's Christianity and then there's a corruption of Christianity, and that certainly falls in the corruption pile.
I've got plenty of things against Christianity, but probably the worst thing I have is the hypocrisy of it. The hypocrisy of its adherence, right? And if these people are actually going to bring people more into what should be Christianity at its base, I'm okay with that, you know. If we can't be the religion now, we will later, but that's another thing. Did you guys hear that right here in Canada, the education minister, Rob Fleming, said of Barry Neufeld, remember Barry Neufeld, that guy in Chilliwack, who basically condemned and attacked the LGBT mm-hmm. community because of the SOGI curriculum there? He basically said that Neufeld's behavior was shameful and unacceptable.
Do you understand the words that are coming out of my mouth?
Yay.
Yeah, exactly. So the minister actually came out and denied that. Neufeld, however, in the meantime, spoke at what they call the Culture Guard. This is a group. It was an event last Tuesday, and the Culture Guard apparently is one of those hate groups, essentially, and they try to defend, quote, the natural family.
Have your concubines and your slaves.
Exactly, and you can trade them for a goat or a chicken.
What is a natural
family? What is the definition of a natural family?
They say natural family because you can't say traditional anymore, because traditional is, it's kind of been debunked.
Out
people
the window,
notice them anyway. So, natural family for them is one man, one woman, that's it.
It'll be interesting. I don't know when he's up for re-election, but I think it'll really be interesting. Is he up next year?
Yeah.
It'll be really interesting to see what happens. Is he going to be the Roy Moore of Chilliwack, or are they going to kick him out in favor of, common sense?
If it was Abbotsford, he might get re-elected.
Chilliwack has a good chance, too. The mayor of Chilliwack is actually a creationist.
Oh,
really?
But the thing is, did he run on the platform of creationism?
No, probably not.
See, the I forget the man's name that we're talking
about.
Barry Neufeld. He's working for the school, and the program he's talking against is part of the school. So it's a little more connected to what his actual job is.
Like most elections, it will really depend, because his conservative base will come out and support him.
Yeah.
Even if it's just to be out of spite.
Yeah.
If the progressive don't come out, then he probably will be reelected.
And the thing is, there's a large community in BC of LGBT and non-mainstream, I guess, traditional people.
Natural.
Yeah, natural people. We're supernatural, guys.
I'll go with that.
Yeah, also, I think it's going to depend, too, on who else is running in the race. If you have someone who is, ultra liberal, and if you have a trans person running and so forth, I don't know how it would work. But I think for that community, if they have someone who's really well-grounded and inclusive and speaks on behalf of most of the people in the community, that person will have a chance to have a seat on the board.
And I nominate Nancy.
Yeah. I think the thing that an opposition individual needs most is just a good platform that they're running on.
Exactly.
It doesn't matter what sexuality, what creed, what religion, what race, as long as they have a good platform.
Good platform,
Exactly. And of course, guys, I'm sorry to announce this, but did you know we're at war again?
Yay!
The war on Christmas has begun.
Because did you know there's lesbians on the Starbucks mug, guys?
That's right.
What's
wrong with...
Starbucks has released a new holiday cup.
It's basically our battle flag. The Starbucks Christmas mug.
It makes the conservatives really angry. They say that Starbucks has a gay agenda, apparently.
What?
Because there's a couple of cartoon women on the cup holding hands. They're sharing a cup and they're... across from each other and they're kind of touching hands. And because of that,
so
Starbucks
what?
Says, well, hey, dude, you gotta live in the conservative mindset.
I know. And the next day I ran out and got a latte so I could have my Christmas cup. And I said, this is a statement.
I might have to go to Starbucks and get the damn Christmas cup.
I want that cup.
I think we all need one.
Yep.
And we're sure if a fat man in a red hat, Joris or Frunstein should be sitting.
I know, I still have my red cup from last year where everybody was complaining that it
wasn't. Well, that was actually from 2 years ago.
Yeah.
Because I think this year might also be part of it is the reason they did that blank mug a couple of years ago is so people could draw on it, and then they've just been using those patterns for the Christmas mugs that they're like customers have
so what,
created.
What's the problem? I'm not getting this conservative mindset thing.
Nobody
is. It's going to turn kids gay if they see two women holding hands.
It's going to turn them gay.
Because did you know it's a choice? It's a choice you make.
Why does my head hurt every time we bring this subject up?
Well, on something a bit more positive, do you guys remember when they had the hashtag MeToo thing trending?
Oh,
well, there's
yes.
another hashtag that started trending. It's called hashtag ChurchToo.
What?
Which
actually,
yes, it starts to trend to talk about sex abuse in religion.
I had no idea.
Oh, this is good.
And this was started by Emily Joy and Hannah Posh. I hope I said this right. So that's interesting because people are talking about, you know, priests abusing them or stuff like that. Hashtag church too.
Wow.
So that becomes
is that gaining any traction or is it at this point?
It's trending. Yeah. It's trending. It's one of those trending hashtags. Did you guys also hear that Trudeau, this is, I don't know, we should almost do a show about this. The Prime Minister Justin Trudeau pledged to prosecute those who join ISIS, but also said that his government would try to reintegrate them into society. Quote, "We recognize the return of even one individual may have serious national security implications. Nearly 180 Canadians left this country to join ISIS. 60 of them have returned. And now the government is thinking of prosecuting these people under the law, but also slowly but surely reintegrate them into the society. Is this a mistake?"
No. Well, it depends what they do to reintegrate them. If they're just like, if it's like, okay, here's a pamphlet of why you shouldn't join an extremist religion. Oh, have fun. But if they educate them and like work with them to, and not in like a 1984 like re-education program where we're brainwashing you, but to just and give them opportunities to say like, okay, are we like what led this person down this path to join ISIS? What could we do better for other people? What could we change? And how can we help this individual lead a productive life?
The thing you have to remember is what Canadian law did these people break?
Yeah, like, I don't know.
So they come back to Canada, and internationally, they have broken laws, we assume. It's up to the government to prove that, and that's where the prosecution would come in. But they've broken no Canadian laws. So to come back, I'm pretty sure. Because we don't have laws that say, you know, if you go over to Syria and commit acts with ISIS, you've broken a Canadian law. There is no Canadian law.
No, but there are
that.
Some laws that says you can't join a group of terrorists or stuff like that.
Okay, so that's what they can get them on is the terrorism.
Yeah,
but now we have convicted murderers in this country who serve their time and then they're released.
Mm-hmm.
We don't have any evidence saying that these people have killed anyone. We don't have any evidence saying they've tortured anyone. We have no evidence.
Are they saying that they're going to jail? Or just
prosecution. They're saying that they want to prosecute them, and then they want to reintegrate them into society.
Mm-hmm.
We have a correctional system here. It doesn't work very well, but we do have that philosophy of a correctional system.
We do have a rehabilitation system.
Exactly. It's a rehabilitation system. So I just had this discussion with my son, and I had to tell him he was adamant that, boy, this is the wrong way to go. But the thing is that we live under a country where the rule of law is prominent. If you start ignoring that rule of law because of your feelings towards what these people have done, what position they've taken, that's a very slippery slope to be going down.
So the real question happens to be, are these jihadists or wannabe jihadists people that can be rehabilitated, or are they just hopeless?
No, this
I think it has to be on a case-by-case basis. I don't think you can make a sweeping judgment about everybody. So it would have to be, I would think, that that person would have to overcome, you know, ticking the boxes off one by one by one. Mm-hmm. And if someone, you know, has the opportunity to, again, be a productive member of society, that's great. You know, I mean, it happens in so many different ways. Not that it's always parallel, but you have people who are criminals of one way or the other, and they serve their time, and they come out and they work with law enforcement, either in prevention or trying to solve cases where they have have knowledge. So, I guess nothing like treason. I mean, there wouldn't be any.
Might have to do a show.
To look it up. This is it's unique, so I have no idea.
Do a show on that.
Yeah. Did you guys?
Actually, I have something to say on this matter because of having lived in Germany and, of course, in Europe. They've been dealing this for a while. France, Germany, and a number of other countries, Holland too, with Muslims that were born there that then left the country to join ISIS. And, of course, they do present a security risk, but at the same time, some of these individuals have been rehabilitated successfully and are helping to turn the tide. I mean, you have to look at why some of these males have joined ISIS, and most of them are male. The other one is they're marginalized. Let's say, especially in France, a lot of them come from the banlieue, Paris, and some of these individuals just don't see a future for themselves, and that's part of the problem. They've just been sort of abandoned by society, and I think that is something that they really need to look at. Like, if they don't want youngsters to be brainwashed and join this kind of organization, well, then maybe they should look at being a little more inclusive and provide them with a future.
I agree.
Mm-hmm. And the whole program, if it's properly done, what Justin Trudeau's government is proposing, would put us in a position to learn from these people exactly what Annette was saying. We're going to learn why they did what they did.
Why the message was
clear. And what do they actually believe in now? And hopefully from that, we can help to curb it from happening again and again, right?
Excellent.
Okay. Anyway, I think that's a good idea, Kevin. Show on that,
because
it's a huge thing.
Did you guys hear that Robert Mugabe finally stepped down after 37 years in Zimbabwe at the government?
Yeah.
At the age of 93. He was always depicted as the typical African dictator. He ended up firing his vice president, Emerson, Mnangagwa, and replaced him with his wife, Grace, and that was basically the straw
turning
that
broke point.
The straw that broke the camel's back. He basically lost all his support at that point. Interesting thing about Zimbabwe, you know, when the crisis of 2008, the economic crisis of 2008 happened, the inflation of Zimbabwe climbed up 231 million%.
Wait,
what?
What?
Oh, yes. 231 million%.
I want to ask you a bunch of questions. I want to have them answered immediately.
So you could have a trillion Zimbabwe dollars. It was worth essentially
nothing. Oh, my gosh.
Yeah. So now this Emerson character is, they know him as the crocodile of Zimbabwe. He will be the president. So,
wow.
As much as he was apparently a despicable person by a lot of accounts, there are some things that he did that were actually positive. Zimbabwe, for example, has one of the highest literacy rates in Africa. So,
and education was important.
Yeah, the end of an era for that country, but it's interesting to see that.
It's good he's gone. I don't care how much good he did. Someone else can do some good and be, you know, a more benevolent dictator.
Oh, yeah, exactly. And, of course, we have to talk about what just happened. This is some of the latest news. A mosque in Sinai was attacked.
Oh,
as we speak, as we're recording this right now, they've counted 300-plus dead.
Yeah.
Oh,
27
wow.
of them are children, 128 injured. Apparently, 25 to 30 armed men assaulted the Al-Radwa Sufi Mosque with automatic machine guns. They took position at the entrances, and apparently they were carrying an ISIS flag. But the response, no response was claimed. Usually ISIS has
That is really weird.
So the president, Abdel Fattah el-Sisi, vowed a response with brute force. This is Muslim-on-Muslim violence, obviously. Sufi...
is it Sufi or Sunni?
No, Sufi.
No, these were Sufis.
Sufi Islam is actually considered heretical by jihadists.
Got it.
So, unfortunately, it's very sad.
Very sad.
That is sad that children were... murdered.
No, another attempt by the religious piece, right?
Yep.
Yeah. Oh, it's tragic.
And of course, on something a bit more positive, it was a birthday this week. Our dearest Christina's birthday.
Oh yeah, put me right after the murder. Thanks.
I'm finishing on a positive note here.
Yeah.
Dearest, happy birthday.
Thank you.
Happy birthday.
She just turned 13.
Yep. Totally. I finally can get my ears pierced now, guys. I am a real teenager.
It was a big week for you, right? Because you it's your birthday and...
Yep. Kirsten and I got engaged.
Yay! Hooray!
And there was much rejoicing.
Yep.
We'll do a podcast.
Not in my family, though.
Poo on them.
So much happiness in 1 week.
Conservatives everywhere are cringing right now.
Yep.
Think about it this way. You're starting a new family now.
Hell yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's going to be great.
And it involves owning horses. So it's better.
And we'll do a show live at the wedding. No, just kidding.
Yeah, totally. Totally. We can walk around and interview my religious relatives and be like,
oh, can we please? That would be hilarious.
That would be
hilarious.
Fabulous. That would be very interesting.
You won't get much from my family, but from hers?
Oh, yeah.
On this wonderful day, do you still feel like a bigot?
Yes. Oh, my God.
With the mic in their face.
Are you planning on stoning the happy couple afterwards?
Are you bringing something like a shield to block them from coming back?
Oh my gosh.
Do you live in a glass house?
Yeah. Oh my gosh.
So that's fantastic. All right, my dear Nancy, what do you got for us this week?
Nothing.
Oh, okay.
No.
You've been saying that for the past couple of weeks.
I can't use that one again. I got to come up with something. All right.
Are we doing
it
this day in history?
It's this day in history.
All right.
And as we all know, because we've been paying attention, this day in history is a roundup of those events and people who altered and illuminated the days between November the 20th and the 26th. Boy, this month is just practically gone. November the 22nd was Independence Day in Lebanon, which was a good thing. However, in 1963, in Dallas, Texas, U.S. President John F. Kennedy was assassinated, and Texas Governor John Connally was seriously wounded, and Lee Harvey Oswald was captured and charged with the murder of both the president and police officer J.D. Tippit. So many of these things now are, you know, we can almost all recite them by rote. And then, of course, Oswald was shot 2 days later by Jack Ruby while in police custody, and Lyndon Johnson became president on Kennedy's death. And we always hear about that part of the story, but we don't always hear what actually what the atmosphere was like at Parkland Hospital for the people who were there and trying to save Kennedy's life, which was a bare thread. And so I came across a letter that I thought was really interesting that was written to the employees right after the event, and it was written by C.J. Price, who was the administrator, and I thought that maybe this deserves a little more air and credit than it's gotten up to now. Mr. Price said to all employees at 12:38 p.m. Friday, November the 22nd, 1963, President John F. Kennedy and Texas Governor John Connally were brought to the emergency room of Parkland Memorial Hospital after being struck down by the bullets of an assassin. At 1:07 p.m. Sunday, November 24th, 1963, Lee Harvey Oswald, accused assassin of the late president, died in an operating room of Parkland Memorial Hospital after being shot by a bystander in the basement of Dallas City Hall. In the intervening 48 hours and 31 minutes, Parkland Memorial Hospital had become the temporary seat of the government of the United States, become the temporary seat of the government of the state of Texas, become the site of the death of the 35th president, become the site of the ascendancy of the 36th president, become the site of the death of President Kennedy's accused assassin, twice became the center of attention of the world, continued to function at close to normal pace as a large charity hospital. What is it that enables an institution to take in stride such a series of history-jolting events? Spirit, dedication, preparedness? Certainly all of these are important, but the underlying factor is people. People whose education and training is sound. People whose judgment is calm and perceptive. People whose actions are deliberate and definitive. Our pride is not that we were swept up by the whirlwind of tragic history, but that when we were not found wanting. That's a beautiful letter to send to people who were just as traumatized as everyone
I'm
else.
I'm trying to compress this in today's words and putting this in a tweet.
Oh my gosh.
Them, yeah.
He was giving them something positive to
something,
hold on to.
Something positive.
You guys are not losers.
Exactly. Exactly. Because it took Dallas a long time to overcome everything that happened on those
good
two
mark,
days.
That's a good mark of leadership.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He'd give his people something positive to hold on to after the trauma.
Exactly.
Yep.
November the 24th, on a more positive note, was Evolution Day, which was the anniversary of the publication of Darwin's On the Origin of Species.
Yay!
November 25th was International Day for the Elimination of Violence Against Women. And in 1949, Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer appeared for the first time on the charts.
Wow.
Aww. That goes back 1949. Damn. And I still hate
long,
it.
Long, long time.
I can get about halfway through, and then it's like, please, I've got to start in the station.
I think it depends what time of year. If it's like 3 days it before is. Christmas, it's fine. If it's in November, no.
I just like all the little extras you add in.
Look, I was
like
in,
Monopoly.
I was in the mall doing my insurance for my car the other day, and they had the Christmas music on, and while I'm standing at the insurance desk, I'm listening to this, and I'm thinking to myself, it's not even December yet.
Yeah. Hey,
and
Christmas
I looked
starts
at the
October
lady
1st.
Behind the counter. I looked at the lady behind the counter. I said, how do you do it? Yeah. And she says, we learn to ignore it.
Hey, wait a minute. I'm calling you out, Mr. Scott, because I remember quite a while back, I was talking about the Christmas creep and how they were bringing eggnog right away, and this was like in June somewhere, and you already saying, well, I'm fine with that.
I'm
you
can't fine be with eggnog.
No.
Eggnog doesn't have to be
It's a
Christmas.
Package deal, sir. It's a package deal.
Oh, come on.
So how do you all feel about the fact that Black Friday is now in Canada?
I love it. I love it so much.
Really?
I love Black Friday.
Okay, what
I just
Black
got a really
Friday
good deal on a car.
About?
I
mean,
that's dude.
I don't even know what it's about.
It's
Black Friday.
It's like Boxing Day.
Black Friday is a sale day. It's after Thanksgiving,
American
or is it before Thanksgiving?
No, it's the day after.
It's the Friday after U.S.
Yeah,
Thanksgiving.
It's a
what
huge
is the
sale.
Meaning of it? Yeah.
The original.
Do you know why they call it Black Friday?
No.
It's Black Friday because that's the start of the season when they're in the black. The
yes.
retail is positive.
Right.
That's when the sales start in the black.
So that's
that.
Why these big sales are on because, hey,
correct.
Now that we're making money, we're
that's
not
right,
actually
in
sucking
black.
Back. Now we can offer some really, really good deals.
Yeah.
Right?
I love it.
The deals are amazing.
And of course, you know,
I lock myself up
in
the shed.
You watch the news from the States. I don't know what Black Friday's done this year, But in the past years, people have killed themselves over televisions.
Oh, yeah, it's insane in the States.
People got trampled to death because there was 5 items on the shelf, mm-hmm. and there was 2,200 people trying to get into the store that was only rated for 900.
Yeah. the one thing I like about Black Friday is they've moved it online.
Yeah.
So you
Which
can...
has taken a lot of the foot traffic away.
Exactly. Yeah.
That's okay. I'm fine with that.
And in 1924, in New York City, the first Macy's Thanksgiving Day Parade was held. Does anybody ever watch any of those?
No.
Yeah. I would always have to miss it because I would have to go to school.
Darn education.
I know.
Yeah. And let's see. That's also the start when most of the holiday windows are up. So now we're absolutely in the season. So we might as well end that.
Now
on a
I
nice
can now I can wear my ugly Christmas sweater and
absolutely.
I won't be looked at weird.
Christmas lights are actually pretty.
They
I
are.
Have to say,
and
when you
Advent.
See a street of
growing up, we started our Christmas lights going up. October 1st.
And that's why Christmas begins October 1st.
Let me just explain, guys. We had over 50,000 Christmas lights. We went insane.
Okay, you did go insane. We had to put ours up because the ladder doesn't stick to ice very well.
Oh, my gosh.
So Christmas lights had to be up before the snowfall.
Right? And starting the Christmas season, we'll end this day in history on that positive note. And it brings to a close another passing parade of interesting, mundane, unusual, and occasionally bizarre events and people that make up this day in history.
Thank you, Nancy.
Thank you, Nancy.
That was wonderful. Good job.
Yay.
My Christmas light, I usually take off one of my light bulbs and put a black light or something.
That's
it.
Not Christmas.
Nancy is wearing Christmas colors.
I'm much
Nancy
more of a Halloween
is.
Guy than a Christmas guy.
Hey. When the children were little, then Christmas was wonderful. Mm. I treasure those times. But after the kids all grow up, you know, instead of presents, I think people ought to donate the money. Mm-hmm. Well, this is a suggestion. I think instead of buying stuff that people really don't need, I think the money would go much better of donating it to some charity or activist
Scott's Car
organization.
Fund.
Yeah,
or some
exactly.
organization that can benefit from that, from the spirit of Christmas.
On what you were saying about watching kids open presents, I was always the youngest growing up. So, I was always like the kid that everyone watched open presents. And for a period of like when I was a teenager to only a couple years ago, like Christmas, I did not enjoy it because I'm like, this is so boring. Like, it was just, I always was like, oh, everyone else is getting more presents. And like, why am I not getting presents? Am I not loved? But now that I have all my nieces and nephews starting to open presents, it's amazing. Like, I don't even care if I get any presents. I just love watching the joy
Giving
on these kids' faces
fun.
As they open a book that I got from a secondhand store.
And now you're actually going to have a little sister.
Yeah, Harry Potter loving sister. I'm so excited.
I knew Harry Potter was coming up in here somewhere.
Yeah, it
happened. Kirsten has a younger sister who's obsessed with Harry Potter, just like me.
Well, thank you so much for that, guys. So let's move on to our segment that we always love called Another Brilliant Moment.
Brought to you by religion. Ha,
thank you.
I cut you off.
I should just have you do the segment. I'm fine with that, too. I've got lots of stories this week. Lots of stories. So let's start with the one about a wonderful Christian hypocrisy.
There's only one?
Yeah.
All right.
You're on a roll today.
An anti-gay family values lawmaker resigned after being caught in a, quote, inappropriate sexual affair with a man in his office.
Yep.
This is Ohio State Representative Wes Goodman, a married, anti-gay, anti-abortion, conservative Christian.
It's almost at the point where it's like, okay, what is it, like, I can't do it. It's like where you protest too much.
That was protest too much.
So if his boyfriend got pregnant, would he want an abortion?
Well, this was a guy who promoted natural marriage, has announced his resignation from the Ohio House of Representatives over the allegation of an inappropriate sexual affair with a man. So he sends a letter of resignation. I'm not going to read the whole thing here, but after a while, it reads, We all bring our own struggle and our own trials into public life. This has been true for me, and I sincerely regret that my actions and choices have kept me from serving my constituents and our state in a way that reflects the best ideals of public service. Yeah, best ideals, my ass. For those whom I have let down, I'm sorry. As I move into the next chapter of my life, I sincerely ask for privacy.
What?
For myself, my family, and my friends. This guy has the gall to ask for privacy after being so against everything.
You know, you really have to wonder about someone who has so much sexual repression and feels as though they have to be the voice of conservative religious beliefs, and that struggle of knowing that you have a tendency toward loving another man or wanting to be with boys.
Wow,
or
loving another human being.
And at the same time, fighting that by being the voice against that. How does a person like that function
sometimes
every day with that kind of a war going on inside of their mind and their emotions?
Not the first, not going to be the last.
Sometimes when, I know from experience, when you have these feelings that you think are wrong and evil, it's so much easier to turn them in the hatred you have for yourself outward. And I when I was younger, I actually had a massive crush on a girl, and I didn't even realize it, but I hated this girl. And I had no reason to hate her, but I hated her.
Yeah.
And it wasn't till when I was older and realized that I was attracted to women as well, that I met her again. I'm like, oh, that's why, you're freaking gorgeous. I found her very attractive. And at that time, my brain just was easier to, okay, I don't know how to deal with this emotion. We're just going to funnel it into this kind of acceptable one.
If there wasn't the sexual repression that the church and the religion offers, these incidents wouldn't happen.
No.
It just wouldn't happen.
No, because it's okay, I am attracted to guys. Okay, let's have sex with a guy.
Isn't that amazing? What you just said really is kind of cool. The being attracted to or loving someone from the same sex is unacceptable.
Yeah.
So you channeled that
into hatred.
Hatred, which is acceptable.
Yeah.
Doesn't that say something about our society?
That's what I'm saying. To go through that, and to take it to the extreme where you're part of a moral, movement, against it, so that you make other people miserable.
Yeah, even it's knowing acceptable. Acceptable.
If someone finds out, I have to prevent that at all costs because then I'm part of them.
It's so, you said, the hypocritical part comes out real close. It's not okay to love somebody because of the same sex as you, but it's okay to hate them.
Yeah. But God is love.
And remember, God loves you. Yeah. Don't screw up or you're going to hell forever and ever
but
and
God
ever.
God loves you.
Here's another brilliant thing. They had a church shooting not too long ago?
Yeah.
Well, a man accidentally shot himself and his wife in an East Tennessee church on Thursday while he was showing off his gun.
How?
Showing off his gun in a church.
How? In a church.
Loaded.
During a discussion on recent church shootings. So
here's how you shoot yourself in the face. Oh, whoops, and now I'm dead.
So the elder members of the First United Methodist Church in Tellico Plains were cleaning up about 1 p.m. after enjoying a luncheon held to celebrate Thanksgiving. They began discussing about guns in churches because now the churches are saying, let's arm ourselves in case we're attacked.
Wow, because that always makes everybody safer, adding more guns to uneducated people.
So a man in his 80s pulled out a 38 caliber Ruger handgun and said, "I carry my handgun everywhere."
With the safety off.
That's right. He removed the magazine
and
through the chamber and showed the gun to some of the men of the church. He put the magazine back in, apparently loaded around the chamber, and returned the gun to his holster. And somebody else walked up and said, "Hey, can I see it?" And he pulled out it out again with the loaded indicator. And again, I can tell that it's not loaded. And he pulled the trigger. He just forgot that he reloaded the
gun.
How did he
shoot himself and his wife?
He deserves the Darwin Award.
Yeah, the bullet sliced the palm of the man's hand and entered the left side of his wife's abdomen and exited the right side.
Oh my gosh. Of course, she got more injured.
She's also in her 80s too, right?
Oh my gosh, seriously, she's in her 80s?
Both of them are in their 80s.
Oh wow. Okay, that puts this into a different dumbass. Picture.
Hey,
wow.
They got guns. They don't need anything else.
You know, and it's funny. It's funny because basic gunmanship, what we were taught in the military, it doesn't matter how many times you've cleared that chamber. Every time you pick that weapon up, you clear the chamber, mm-hmm. and you look in the chamber to make sure it's clear. Doesn't matter if you just cleared it. If you set the weapon down and you pick it back up, you clear the chamber again if you're going to hand it off to someone.
Yeah.
And you verify with them the chamber's clear.
Well, that ensures the fact that the gun owner is aware of what that weapon can do, and they've either been to classes or they've passed, you know, the tests, and they understand what's going on.
Yeah.
When you have someone who just has a gun and they don't care about any of that, or they've forgotten about that, or they've never been to class, those are the guys that
yep.
you really and this guy's a
and
perfect
you
example.
See, you see on movies, it's like, oh, you just have to pick up a gun and you can shoot people.
No.
Like that's all it takes.
Yeah,
you
I mean,
pick up a gun.
You've got responsible gun owners, and you've
yeah.
got
yeah.
It's like people who think they know karate because they watch Jackie Chan.
Yeah.
It's like, no, you can't use a gun just because you watch John Wick.
Yeah.
Doesn't happen.
Well, I just don't understand this prevalence of keeping it. You want to carry your gun? Fine. I don't have a problem with that. You want to carry your gun around? Why is there a round in the chamber ready to fire? Why is it cocked ready to fire?
Yeah,
it doesn't need to be.
No.
And that extra half a second it takes to cock it is not going to change the outcome of a gun battle.
No.
All right. I got to move on here. So, there's another story. End Time broadcaster Rick Wiles. Heard of this guy? He
saw
in his True News radio programs on Friday that America has become so wicked that and immoral that God sent angels to this country. If God would send angels to this country, you know what would happen?
They'd shoot them.
No, gay man would try to rape them.
Excuse me?
Yes.
What?
Citing the biblical tale of Sodom and Gomorrah.
Oh, yeah, that makes
like,
sense.
Like, that's a bloody reference. Laws insisted that the 6-6 society has nothing on modern-day America.
Yep.
Quote, I think right now, if God sent angels to this country, homosexuals would attempt to rape them.
Yeah, but they can't rape the angels, but you can rape my daughters. That's totally fine.
Can you get an angel pregnant?
I don't know.
Who would be the father? Who would be the mother?
You're just left with feathers in your mouth. It's like, it's really not good.
Could you give an angel an abortion?
I don't know. Well, no, Nephilim.
I mean,
Nephilim exist.
Did he lay an egg?
Did they lay an egg?
You're very right.
Yeah.
I'm telling you, he continued, if angels right. arrived in some major cities in this country, men would seek to rape them. We have become that wicked. So, kind of makes you wonder if Wiles' daughters would be put out if these angels raping gay men.
Oh, my gosh.
All these angel raping gay men would arrive.
And
maybe his wife will turn into salt, too.
And the bad thing is that there are a substantial number of people who believe exactly what that guy is saying.
Yeah, it's just amazing.
That's
to
scary.
Me, I mean,
okay,
he's sick, but the fact that people are saying, yes, you know, we believe in everything that you're saying, and that's right, that's the danger, the followers.
Oh, yeah, it's pretty amazing. I've got another story, but I want to change the music here because it's just
Uh-oh.
Ridiculous.
I kind of know what music he's putting. Yeah, I kind of figured.
All right. Did you guys hear about the guy named Mad Mike Hughes?
No, but I love his name.
He's a self-taught rocket scientist.
Yes.
Ooh,
yes.
Self-taught.
Okay, I did hear about this.
He's also
hear about
known
this.
As a limo driver. He's got a lot of time in his hands. He's planning to launch himself today over a town in California.
Is he going to live stream it?
I don't know. But in a homemade rocket that says, Research Flat Earth across the side.
Oh my gosh.
Now, he plans to test his rocket this weekend, and if successful, the trip should demonstrate the curvature of the Earth and disprove his nonsense. But he doesn't think that will happen. Instead, he's betting that he can build a rocket powerful enough to get him into space so that he can take a photo of the Flat Earth, proving NASA wrong.
I hope he has
all of his affairs in order.
$20 says he gets hurt. Come on.
Oh.
Betting with me here.
This one's only going to get him to an altitude of 1,500 feet or something.
Yeah,
I'm
getting
it. But does he realize that to survive in space, you need very specialized equipment?
Oh, he's just going to stop before the dome. He's going to glide on the
door. There is no space, remember.
Okay. But he said space.
Well, he's going to go up to where we look at, and the dome covers.
He's going to break the glass.
He's going to hit it.
He's going to... Yeah, it'll be like that movie where the rocket goes to the moon. Remember that one, the first sci-fi movie ever?
Yeah.
And a rocket crashes into the moon? Yeah, it'll be like that. His rocket will be sticking out of the dome. Yeah. You'll be able to wave at him. He'll be hanging there.
All I'm thinking of is the birds with those Windex commercials.
The guy says, I don't believe in science. The guy says, I don't believe in science.
Then why did he build a rocket?
I don't know. Whose main sponsor for the rocket is Research Flat Earth. That's a group. He says, I know about aerodynamics and fluid dynamics and how things move through air.
He doesn't believe in science.
No.
I bought a certain size of rocket nozzle and thrust, but that's not science.
That's not science?
That's just a formula, he says.
That's what science is.
There's no difference between science and science fiction. This guy's brilliant.
And there's no such thing as an atmosphere, guys. It's an atmos flat.
Yes, that's right. That's right. She pulled that from the story. Atmos flat.
Yeah. So,
you know, in today's world, there's no sense in reading fiction to get away from reality.
No, you don't even need
reality. I'm just wondering.
So we had to question it, and it was actually in the story. I forget what they said. That there was comments under the story where people asked, "Why didn't he just get a weather balloon and go up?" Because we attach cameras to weather balloons all the time now, and they go really high. Mm-hmm. They'll go up into the hundreds of thousands of feet. And, you know, a lot of the Canadian people just turned around and said, you know, we can get a flight with WestJet for a few hundred bucks and get up to 40,000 feet just like that. Like, what? But then somebody said, well, no, he would claim that that's all just a ruse by the airlines. It's a ruse by the airlines.
They've discovered teleportation, and you aren't actually, like, in the air.
They're not windows all over the screens.
Exactly.
I'll show you the same movie.
When is he going?
Today. His rocket launches all the photos he takes while miles above Earth will ultimately disprove the spherical planet theory, according to the Washington Post. Quote, I'll shut the door to this ball Earth, Hugh says, in a fundraising interview with a flat Earth group on Saturday. Theories discussed during the interview include NASA being controlled by a round Earth Freemason and Elon Musk making fake rocket from blimps.
Good film at
11. Yeah. Hughes promised the Flat Earth community that he would expose the conspiracy with a steam-powered rocket. This will be fun. Which will launch from a heavily modified mobile home. There we go.
The story.
Though he acknowledged that he still had much to learn about rocket science, he plans on reaching 1,800 feet.
That's it.
Which is 550 meters, which is the height of the CN Tower.
Wait.
He's not going to see the curvature.
Wait,
you can't see
it's not enough to see the curvature.
You can't see the curvature out an airplane window.
I like your idea, Scott. I'm hoping that he hits the dome.
Yeah.
And then he can wave, and then he can write notes on the dome.
Exactly.
And he can message back and forth.
Hey, there we go. We could start a campaign to send him spray paint, fluorescent spray paint. And he can actually write messages on the dome, like graffiti.
Now I'm with it. I wasn't until we see there's an absolute benefit to this. Now I'm let him go.
I think he watched the Truman Show a little too much. But also, how is he planning on landing?
Oh, I don't know. I didn't have the details. Apparently, there's some shitty parachutes somewhere they're involved.
Well, if it's a shitty parachute, then he'll be.
That's really worrying.
$20 says he injures himself somehow.
Yeah. $20 says he pulls an evil Knievel.
Injures himself or dies.
Yep.
Oh my God!
Oh, he apparently was friends with Evel Knievel. He knew Evel Knievel or something.
Evel Knievel.
Evel Knievel was one of the greatest stuntmen that ever lived. It was a big thing back in the 60s and 70s.
I think I've
seen videos.
People
of
would actually
what he
go
did.
Out and do stunts on purpose. Yeah. So one of the stunts Evel Knievel did was to try and rocket propel himself. He was a motorcycle rider and right. That's a lot of his stunts were done on motorcycles, and he tried to rocket propel himself across the Grand Canyon, which failed.
Did he die?
No, he broke. No, he broke something like 203 out of 206 bones in his body.
But and he survived?
Oh yeah, yeah. Evel really Knievel was—he was. Read up on it; it's really cool.
He apparently made a deal with the devil.
Really tough guy.
Well, let's give an update on this guy.
Oh yeah, definitely.
Next week, or we
next
can
talk about the funeral.
if we could get a microphone to him up in the dome, he can report next week.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That would be wonderful.
Live from the dome.
Just a little little balloon with some helium and a big cable.
That's our next guest.
Our next guest. Yeah. Oh, my God. What a clown.
We could put, yeah.
Thank you, guys. Thank you so much for bearing with me on this. So let's take a quick pause, and we'll be right back with Nate Phelps. So stay with us.
Hi, I'm the Supreme Irreverend Dr. Randy Tyson from the Legion of Reason Diversion. Join me and my co-hosts, Christine Shelska, Twyla, and Nate Phelps, as we explore issues at the intersection of atheism, humanism, and skepticism. Topics range from alternative medicine to the interference of religion in public policy. We often have special guests to help us understand the topic du jour. Previous guests include biologist Jerry Coyne, ex-Muslim author Ali Rizvi, philosopher Peter Boghossian, and the late physicist Victor Stanger. You can watch us on the Legion of Reason YouTube channel or subscribe to the audio version through your favorite podcatcher such as iTunes or Stitcher. And don't forget to like the Legion of Reason Facebook page.
With religious people taking over the world, I mean, we can either speak up or be pushed into a corner. I'm proud to be an
atheist. What happens when you're an atheist living in the Canadian Bible Belt? If you're like me, you gather some friends and you take to the airwaves. So I invite you to come and join us every week to take a left of the valley and find out where you stand in this world. Follow us on iTunes, YouTube, Spreaker, Blog Talk Radio, or SoundCloud, or leftofthevalley.com. Atheist, skeptic, and humanist radio, no God required.
Faith in God is like a virus, so why would I respect it? The line between good and evil gets blurred once infected. The truth you neglected.
A Monday warrior, mean stride. Today's Tom Sawyer, mean pride.
It's also taught us, just in my lifetime, an enormous amount more about how little we know, because we have now an increasingly large idea of the fantastic expanse of the unknown. That's precisely the moment at which to say that skepticism is what's necessary. Inquiry, debate, doubt. Where's faith in this? Where's the usefulness of faith there? There's no use to it at all.
Okay, so our next guest is none other than the fantastic, the fabulous, the one and only Nate Phelps. Nate, thank you so much for joining us at Left of the Valley.
Oh, jeez. Thanks for having me, guys.
Nate, I'm going to be super honest with you right from the get-go here. I wasn't sure that I wanted to bring you on the show because you have such a fantastic story, and I've heard your story, and I've heard you tell it, and you've told it many, many times. But at the same time, I wanted you to come and tell your story to our audience, but I didn't want to pull off a scab or open an old wound or stuff like that. So are you good for telling us the Nate Phelps story? You good with that?
Yeah, you bet. Not a problem at all.
Fantastic. So I guess the mic is all yours, Nate. Give us the Nate Phelps story.
Okay. Well, so I grew up in Topeka, Kansas. My father was Fred Phelps of the Westboro Baptist Church. Mm-hmm. We grew up in a I have 12 brothers and sisters. It was the church that during the time I was there, there was just us and two other families. Primarily because every time my father got behind the pulpit, he pissed someone off. So no one wanted to stay in the church very long. You know, every once in a while we'd get visitors, but they wouldn't last more than one sermon, or maybe a couple more, and then they'd move on. So it was his theology was Calvinism, which, for those who don't know it, it's basically Christianity turned on its head because Calvin said that humans don't get to choose whether they're saved. That's God's job. So it's considered a kind of a variation, a distorted version of Christianity by most people today, although a lot of Baptists still claim to be Calvinists. Anyway, I don't want to go too far down that road, but he was an extreme version of it. Taught us that basically that place was the only place left on earth where there were people who were going to go to heaven. He had all kinds of bizarre beliefs based on, he really was in love with the Old Testament, and you can imagine where that takes people.
Yeah.
So he was teaching us that, God was going to, or Christ was going to come back around the year 2000, and that everybody was going to burn, or the few that were saved were going to go up into heaven. And he was actually convinced that he wasn't going to die, that he would see the return of Christ before he actually suffered, human death. So it was a fairly isolated childhood growing up there, because in large part because he thought that we were supposed to be separated from the rest of the world. So he found ways to do that, including browbeating and putting pressure on the public schools that we were attending to make sure that we weren't involved with any kind of what he considered religious activities. So when Christmas came around, we would be sent out of the classroom to go to the library while they were doing Christmas things, singing carols or whatever. So there was a huge push, a lot of pressure put on the kids as we were growing up, that we were required to be warriors for Christ, I guess is the best way to put it, but be aggressive in putting that message out there and condemning the world, not shy away from it, which was a huge problem for me from the very beginning, because, quite frankly, I just wasn't comfortable at all with telling people they were going to burn for eternity in hell, right? So, and then there was the, he had this strong message about the second-class nature of women, that because of Eve's transgression in the Garden of Eden, that women were second-class citizens and they were to be ruled by men. And then there was the passages that talked about how children were to obey their parents, and parents were supposed to raise them up, and the nurture and admonition of the Lord, and spare the rod, spoil the child. So all of that kind of came together to form a very violent environment when we were growing up there. He was physically and verbally and emotionally violent towards our mother if he thought that she wasn't doing what he wanted her to do, if she wasn't what he called in subjection to him. He would beat her, and he at one point, because he was upset about something that she had said, he grabbed a pair of scissors and cut off all of her hair, which was...
Dick move.
Yeah, which was a direct, it was directly related to the Bible. It was very symbolic, because women aren't supposed to have short hair. Mm-hmm. And specifically, he taught that word in the Bible that says long hair translates to uncut. So he was making a statement by cutting her hair off like that.
Wow.
that she wasn't in subjection, and that she wasn't a godly woman. And then that carried over to how he behaved towards his children as well. He was brutally violent when he would get upset, and he got upset a lot. So he would use what was called a mattock handle. I don't know if you guys are familiar with that.
No.
It's a tool a little bigger than an axe. It's got a hoe. The metal part is, one end of it is shaped like a hoe. The other is shaped like an axe. So you can basically use it to dig out roots out of the ground. Mm-hmm. And he would use the handle of that, which was about 4.5 feet long, and it had about a 12-13 inch circumference on the base end. And he would swing that like a baseball bat to beat the kids when they had done something that he didn't approve of. Oh, and to the point where their backside from behind the knees to the lower back would be split open and bleeding.
Oh my God.
Wow.
So it was that, and then there was a lot of other examples of that. He would give himself over to the rage whenever he'd get upset about something. And he was upset a lot because he was under a tremendous amount of pressure. He also, because he couldn't make a living out of preaching, he had gone back to school and got a law degree. So he practiced law for, I'm going to say probably 15 to 20 years, ended up getting disbarred.
You said from an early childhood you were kind of pushed to judge people and condemn people. How early was that?
From our very earliest memories, we were in church literally from the day we were born every Sunday for 3 hours. So we were being preached to constantly. And, as we came of age, if circumstances came up, sometimes we'd have people who were coming over, like the Jehovah's Witnesses would come to the door, and we would attack them. I mean, literally, I can remember one time when we were literally chasing a couple of people down the street, screaming at them that they were going to hell.
Oh my gosh, they're probably not used to that.
Yeah, right. Like they thought they were extreme. So, it was just a part of the culture growing up there. And so as opportunities presented themselves, and you got to understand, it wasn't like he was, the average Christian or religious person imagines that when they sit in church on a Sunday, that they're going to get a message of inspiration, or, they're going, every once in a while, the preacher will talk to them about the standard of God and, what's expected and what's sinful and what isn't. But by and large, at least my experience with mainstream Christianity in the later years was that it was an opportunity to kind of get your battery recharged and to hear an inspirational message and leave there feeling motivated and positive about things. Well, in our circumstances, we were basically being indoctrinated into the nature of the world, all of the evils that were out there, all of the ideas that and how they were ran in contradiction to the truth of the Bible and why this particular preacher was wrong and why he was going to hell and all of his congregants were going to hell, why this individual was wrong and how they were attacking the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. And then there was this tendency on his part to make everything so extreme. So if someone was preaching a certain doctrine or something as simple as using grape juice instead of wine for the Lord's Supper, he would basically present that in such a way that this person was pure evil, that they had a Satan in them, because, wow. And that was the evidence for it, right? He was always looking for evidence.
Crazy.
And his evidence was whether or not they were following the letter of the of the law, in the Bible. So
even if they're using like Welsh grape juice, the really good stuff, they're still evil, right?
Oh yeah, no, you can't. Yeah, exactly. Can't have leaven in the bread. You can't have leaven in the wine.
Special brand. He would hate me.
Yeah. So, it was just that tendency that he had to make everything. It wasn't that this person just had some doctrine wrong for us, right? Okay, so he's in error. You hear that kind of talk all the time. Mm-hmm. But it was proof that this person was evil, or this denomination was evil, and it was. It was a very potent and significant part of his message, was that everything outside of the four walls of that church were soaked in demonic influence, and it was dangerous. And then he turned towards us as the kids that, if we ever got ourselves involved in that, which translated to if we ever left that place or left his control, that we would immediately be immersed in that. We would be subject to God's wrath and revenge as well. So, you know, when the time came that we started developing some thoughts of our own, first of all, because of the message we heard growing up there, any time our minds, or you know, I can only speak for myself at this point, any time my mind would wander and wonder about something that didn't fit that model that he had presented to us, then the first thing you do is you try to shut it down because you think, well, this is Satan talking to me, right?
Yeah.
So it kind of sabotages that capacity, that innate capacity in us to be skeptical and to ask questions. But over the years, as all of us came into adulthood, you know, one by one, the kids were leaving. But as soon as something bad would happen in their lives, they would rush back to the church, to the protection of that place, because that's how they translated, or, you know, anything that bad that happened in their lives. That was the context that they viewed it in.
Yeah. You guys weren't probably instilled with very many good coping mechanisms as kids.
Yeah, no, absolutely not. That's one of the things I talk about when I'm speaking about it, is that when I left there on the night of my 18th birthday, I can't imagine anyone being less prepared for the real world than I was, right? Because there's no focus on that. We're going to be there and going to be under his influence and his control for our entire lives. So there was no reason to teach us, or no inclination to teach us the true nature of the world. So, yeah, I don't know where else to go with that, guys.
Oh, well, wow, it's shocking.
As you were growing up and you started to have some questions, at what point did you really start to realize that not everything that was presented as evil was really evil, that there might be a different kind of a life outside of the church that might offer you some benefits, and that you wanted to understand more than what your father was teaching you?
Yeah, you know what, hon? I would say that it wasn't until late into my adult life that I actually reached that perspective. Mm-hmm. When I was growing up there, it was, by and large, well, let me just put it this way. By the time I had decided to leave, my state of mind was that everything that my father had taught us was true. That I was going to, I can remember sitting in church listening to him, or, you know, he's preaching in the background. And I'm actually doing the math and I'm figuring, okay, so I've got, if I leave on my 18th birthday, I've got another 24 years to live my life, and then I'll deal with the consequences when Christ returns in the year 2000.
Wow.
Because I was convinced I was going to go to hell. So, but what it boiled down to, and I, is that I, that place was so violent and was so dangerous to me, and I had become convinced that regardless of whether my father was right, that I wasn't going to be able to sin, that, you know, I just didn't have any place there. So I left believing I was going to go to hell, but satisfied that this was the best choice for me, that I was going to go out and live my own life for as long as I could, and then I would deal with those eternal consequences when they came. So, and that didn't change for years, because I kind of turned my back on all of that and avoided it like the plague. And then after my kids were born, first of all, the fact that I was able to have kids was a miracle to me, because he had taught us, you know, that was one of the threads running through his message throughout our childhood, that those who were in God's favor were blessed with children. That's why he had so many kids, mm-hmm. because he believed it was a blessing from God. So when my wife became pregnant right after we got married, I was satisfied. I mean, I didn't see an outcome other than she was going to lose that baby, and then we were going to have to deal with that, because I wasn't going to be able to have kids. So then we had our first son, and then 18 months later, we had twins.
Aww.
And all of that kind of came together to create the psychic environment, I guess the best way to put it, in my head, where all that stuff started getting stirred up, mm-hmm. and I had to finally start confronting it. And it was pretty intense. Wow. Because you go into a completely different area when you have kids emotionally, right? The feelings that I had never experienced before in my life, and they were intense. You know, when people talk about spiritual, I look back on the birth of my children as a spiritual experience. It was that profound emotionally. Mm-hmm. And so then you start asking questions. Well, you know, if this is normal, if these kind of powerful feelings and motivations to protect and to love and to cherish and to care for, if those are normal, then what happened back here when I was growing up? Why weren't those emotions there, and what was wrong? You know, then you turn it back on yourself. What was wrong with you? Why wasn't that? Why didn't I experience that? So that's kind of what I attribute that to. But bottom line is, it was around that time in my life that I really started asking a lot of questions and started kind of falling into a hole emotionally. So I went into counseling, and I deliberately found a guy who had a degree in psychology and a degree in theology. He'd gone to, I think it was Dallas Theological Seminary. And I spent about better part of 2 years working with him. And he basically, the way he put it is, he put me through a 2-year theology degree program, as far as all the books he had me reading and the conversations we're having. So it was a very interesting experience, that part of it, because I was able to start looking at some of the actual theology that my dad taught. But one of the things you got to understand about my father is he's very persuasive in this speech, right? He could make the case. And that was his power ultimately. That's, you know, because he did such a good job of making the case that everything else paled as far as the arguments that were out there, right? So, That process with that psychologist was to start dismantling some of that, weakening it, if you will, the effects that it had on me. But one of the bigger outcomes of that process for me was that first seed in my mind that, well, no, wait a minute. Really, all this amounts to is just another version. As good as this guy was at providing the information, it was just another version of an idea that there's really no foundational basis for even holding. You see the point I'm trying to make there? It was like, okay, so he had one version of Christianity. This guy has another one. All of them are convinced that theirs is exactly the right one. But there's no basis for any of them claiming that they have absolute truth. So that was one of the effects of that the time I spent with him. And then I walked or stepped back from that and spent some more time going to church and trying to find the kinder, gentler God of mainstream Christianity. Yeah. And just kept getting more and more depressed. So I went back to another counselor, and he focused more on the physical violence and the psychological violence growing up there, and I ended up going into a mental hospital for a couple of weeks, and that was an interesting experience. Yeah. So anyway, all of that, I went through this process, and somewhere along the way gave myself permission to have my own thoughts and my own ideas about all of these matters, right? So, mm-hmm. and that was the big challenge, because my whole life I was basically deferring to what my father said was true.
You know,
that was the tipping point, I think, when I finally found my own voice and gave myself permission to believe what I wanted to.
Yeah, you were never allowed to think for yourself.
That's exactly right.
Wow.
You know, you were talking about your father being a charismatic figure and all that. Let's do a quick detour here for the Westboro Baptist Church itself. For a lot of people that look on the outside, it seemed more like a very based on the Phelps family itself, how big is the church? I mean, how did he attract? Did he have adherents outside the family, and how did they attract them? Was it charismatic, or was it simply fear?
Well, like I said, there were two other families that were going to the church the majority of the time, if not all the time that I was there. And because I was on the outside, you know, once you leave there, of course, you're cut off and ostracized. And so I was only able to cobble together information like that, you know, from bits and pieces of information that I would get. From what I understand, if you just look at my immediate family and then, you know, their offspring, they're upwards of about 70. And then I would say, I mean, they were claiming about 100 when they were at their peak. And that's possible. I mean, when I sat down at one point and I tried to, you know, to make a list and figure it out. And I think 100 was a fairly reasonable. They tend to exaggerate, so maybe 90. But then over the years of their campaign, between their own efforts to control the situation, they kicked several people out because they either weren't putting enough effort into the pickets, or they were a little too inclined to violence if someone said or did something they didn't like on the picket line. So they got rid of a few of the members that way. And then as my nieces and nephews came of age, there was what I would consider a mass exodus. So now I would say they're down to maybe 50. And the vast majority of them are nine of my siblings and their, you know, and their kids or their grandkids.
Nate, I want to go back to the... can you explain to our audience the night you decided to leave and your exodus, for lack of a better term?
Yeah. Out of the church. Okay, so my older brother Mark had left when I was about... I want to say I was close to 16. And like I said, you know, several others had left before, but they came back. But when Mark left, he stayed gone, in spite of my father's efforts to get him back. So it was the first time that I actually had experienced that, you know, that reality, that someone could actually go and stay gone and be out of the influence of that man. So I started playing around with the idea, and sometime, I think it was in my 17th year, I made the decision that I was going to leave. But also around that time, my oldest sister Kathy had run away, but she was only 17, and so he found out where she was working and then where she was living. And one night we came home, we used to sell candy every night after school, so we came home from candy sales, and he said, you know, he had us all pile back into two cars, and we drove over to her house, and as we pulled up there, there was a guy sitting out in front of her house, and as it turned out, he was there to take her out on a date. And we pulled this kind of Starsky and Hutch move where we, you know, pulled one of the cars at an angle in front of his car so he couldn't move, and then pulled the other one in behind him. And then we all jump out of the car, and we rush up, and we force Kathy back into one of the cars, and we take her home. And we had this big pompous meeting, and the old man pretended like he got the permission of everybody else. And then we locked her up in a room upstairs, and he forced her to fast for, I don't remember how long that particular fast was, but it was 3 or 4 weeks. And he would periodically go up there and, you know, confront her, whatever was eaten at him at the time, and it would turn into a violent beating. And so the lesson was learned, and I realized that if I was going to leave, I wasn't going to do it prior to when I could stay gone legally, right? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So I started planning. There was a security guard at our high school, and he had an old Nash Rambler for sale for $300. So I saved up my money and bought that and secreted it away so nobody knew I had it. And then on the night of my 18th birthday, I waited till everybody had gone to sleep, and I walked the two or three blocks to where the car was, and I drove it. And I had over the last week or two, had packed all my stuff in boxes. So I backed the car into the driveway and opened the garage door and loaded the trunk up with my few belongings. And then I still had about an hour and a half left. So I went back in the house, and I should pause here to tell you that we actually lived, the building that we lived in was also the church building. So there was the sanctuary, and then my father's law office was attached to one side of the sanctuary, and then our house wrapped around the other side in the back of the church, and then there was living quarters upstairs as well. So I was standing, I basically went back into the living room or the dining room, and there were stairs that led up to his room, and then over to the left of those stairs was a bank of refrigerators and freezers, and there was an old red clock that was on the wall up above those. So I stood there and watched the clock rise, and when it hit midnight, I turned around and walked out the back door and got in the car and drove away. I spent the first three nights, I had befriended a guy who owned a gas station that was near the high school that I went to, and I told him what my plans were, and so he gave me a key to the gas station and told me I had to stay in the bathroom, and the way it was situated, I couldn't leave the bathroom because there were all glass, you know, the whole front of the place was glass, and it'd be too easy for the police to see me in there. So I slept in the bathroom there for three nights until my brother's mother-in-law found out about it, and so she took me in and let me live in her attic until I got situated and got a job. So that was how that happened.
Wow.
What a,
you know, usually the show is fairly lighthearted, but this is
serious stuff.
This has got to be one of the most emotional shows we've done.
Oh, my gosh.
Nate, after you left there and you decided to make a life of your own, and you eventually moved to Canada, right?
Yeah, I moved up here in late 2005.
Best decision you ever made.
What's that?
I said, best decision you ever made.
Right? Well, I was in Southern California. When I left there, I fiddled around in the Midwest for about 5 years, and then I ended up moving to Southern California in 1981. And so I was there for 25 years and worked with my older brother, and we had a chain of print shops there. So that was the lion's share of my adult life was there in Southern California, and that's where I met my wife and raised a family.
So I moved
up here.
So now that you're up here and you have a whole different life, is there, do you still have contact with much of, besides your older brother, you still have a lot of contact with some of your siblings or nephew, nieces and stuff? They come and talk to Uncle Nate?
Yeah, I mean, Mark and I, like I said, we worked together for years. He and I have a very good relationship. He's living now down in Phoenix, and we talk regularly. And then one of my younger sisters left, you know, years after we did, and she's the only other one, so there's just the three of us who left and stayed gone. And Dorothy and I have a pretty good relationship. It's just not, we're not as close as because of the geography and the age difference.
Yeah.
So, but yeah, we have a good relationship, and a few of my nieces and nephews I do talk to. A lot of them. See, the other thing you got to remember is that that, you know, one of my father's strategies was, like I said, he was all the time talking about the more sinful people in the world. And I know that when my brother Mark left, suddenly he was the hot topic, and he was always the example that my father would use behind the pulpit for what would happen to you if you left. And, you know, the like Mark got involved in some kind of fringe religious group, and so that was a fodder for my father's sermons a lot. So I know that when I left, that I became that one of those figures as well. And then, of course, when I started speaking out against what they were doing, that just ramped up. So a lot of my nieces and nephews, when they left, as all of us did, we had our own reasons when we left, right? But because of that ideology that we're raised in, we're still very skeptical of everyone else. So it's kind of this, yeah, I know that I left for a good reason, but I'm not so sure about everybody else. You know, they might still be evil like the rest of the world, right? So there's a real coolness between me and most of my nieces and nephews when they first leave. And so it takes a long time, if ever, for me to form a relationship with them.
Yeah, because like, unlike your siblings, your nieces and nephews never would have had a relationship with you before you left.
That's right. Yeah, no, they did a very good job. And we understood that when we were growing up there, that if we left, we were cut off. There was no communication, no interaction. And if anybody tried to, then it was clear that they would be kicked out as well, right? So it was a very effective system of ostracizing.
Well, whatever. If someone comes from an abusive religious background and they are as courageous as you are to take that step, what is the best kind of support that people might need to help them on that journey and to leave that behind and to have a better and, you know, more compassionate, more loving, you know, existence and not have the nightmares that they did? Or just people who come from another religion and are reluctant to, you know, to go out in the world because they are skeptical of what they might find. What support systems work, in your opinion, what do you think works the best?
Yeah, boy, that's a big question. It's huge, and there's so many pieces to that. Yeah. First thing I'd like to say is that when we were growing up, when my generation was growing up, there was no other voice out there. The only time you even heard about atheists was from Christian preachers vilifying them, right? There wasn't anybody out there who was saying, hey, look over here, guys. Of course, you know, you had the Madeline Murray O'Hara, but she was Satan incarnate. You know, they were, you just wouldn't even consider having anything to do with them. So the very fact that the internet exists and that there are voices out there today is huge for those people who are coming away from those kind of environments, because there's a lot of information out there now. That's one positive thing, but that's not really connection and personal relationship. And that's one of the reasons why when I was running CFI in Calgary, that was my primary push. Is just because we leave organized religion doesn't mean we stop being humans and needing rituals and needing communion and interaction with other, you know, with like-minded people. So I've pushed for that all along. And I think that's a huge part of it. Those regular meetings that we had, either as, you know, movie night or as you know, skeptics in the pub or whatever, those were huge for me, being able to process stuff that I, you know, was going through my mind as I was taking steps further away from that environment that I had grown up in. And then, of course, we started seeing organizations cropping up, like Recovering from Religion, which I was on the board of for about 3 years. I think that's a huge resource that lets people get personal contact and have intimate conversations on some of these topics with people who are trained to listen and to ask the right questions and just give them a sounding board, right? And then there's also this whole area of you know, the psychological damage that religious, you know, people that suffer that grow up in those kind of extreme religious groups. And there is a new field of psychology that is developing science and material that helps us understand better exactly the effects of growing up in those kind of environments. So there's a few of those popping up. There's one I can think of on the East Coast. And those groups are invaluable, in my mind, to help people deal with some of the psychological damage that was done to them. Mm-hmm.
Nate, I gotta ask. Now that your father passed away a couple of years ago,
yeah.
I don't want to get too personal. You don't have to answer this if you don't want to, obviously. But how are your feelings about the man?
Yeah. What are you know what? It is. I got that question almost constantly right after he passed away. And it's one of those areas, like so many other areas, where I'm torn. I feel at times that there's something wrong with me because I'm not feeling more emotions about it. And there's times when I feel very strong emotions about it. But none of them, I mean, I guess the best way to say it, you guys, is you're 45 years away from someone. You know, they're basically strangers at that point, right? So it's hard for me to conjure up, and I don't think that that's the purpose of emotion. You're not supposed to conjure up emotions, right? Yeah. But it feels like that's the only way I can get any kind of feelings on the subject is if I sit and think about it. It just wasn't any really powerful. You know, I had a lot of people saying, "Oh, it's still his father," but really, after that much time, it isn't. You know, I mean, there was, to me, it's about relationships and connections. Definitely. And if you don't have that, yeah, with someone, it's hard to feel strong emotions. I mean, what I talked about right after he passed was this idea that it was disturbing to think that kind of mind and that kind of capacity had been wasted to the extent that it was. Even not so much wasted as being as destructive as it was, right? I mean, he could have done so much good in the world, and it was just the opposite. He was counterproductive, and he was terribly destructive to so many people. So I had emotions about that, you know, regrets that for the person that he could have been. But no, I don't. You know, I have much stronger emotions for people who aren't connected to me by blood, that I've had relationships with over the years, right?
Nate, your story is certainly one of courage, and it's certainly one of incredible inspiration, and I thank you so much for it. But let's finish this on a bit more positive note.
Do you like Canada? No, I'm joking.
when you're looking at the future of atheism and maybe the future of the Westboro Baptist Church, what words of wisdom would you give to somebody out there that's having a hard time coming out of their coming to their apostasy in a way?
Well, I don't know about. I mean, I think that it's each journey away from religion is very unique, and it's very, very private. The thought that occurs to me when I think about my family and that church is the same thing that I said early on when I first started talking about it, is these people have fabricated and manufactured a system of belief that has them uniquely positioned to do the Lord's work in this place and time. And they put all of this emotion and this effort into maintaining that system. And I remember saying in an interview years ago that the sad thing is the years will pass and all of these people are going to die and this is going to go away, and the only thing left standing consistently in the world is those actions and those deeds that were loving and supportive and constructive towards other humans. So I don't know if I said that very eloquently, but that's the thought that comes to mind.
I think you did say it very eloquently.
Yes, absolutely. I absolutely concur. Nate, I can't thank you enough for your eloquence and your grace in this interview, and I sure hope our audience can take the lessons there and apply it to their whatever situations they're in. But before I let you go, I got to have you say, "Hi, I'm Nate Phelps, and I took a left at the valley."
Hi, I'm Nate Phelps, and I took a left at the valley.
And that was, what can I say, Mr. Nate Phelps.
Oh, wow.
What a powerful, powerful story.
Absolutely.
Probably one of the most powerful interviews we ever had here on the show.
Absolutely. It is
when you think about when you think about Nate being able to overcome that, and you think about you know, so many other people who are trapped in that kind of environment and are unable to make that kind of transition. But I'm hoping maybe, you know, there will be a time when people aren't abused by religion, but they're liberated from it.
Nate, I, wherever you are, sir, you certainly have friends here, and I salute you. I salute your courage.
Absolutely.
And I sure hope your story goes on to inspire some more people. What a gentleman. I cannot be... Oh, wow. I'm flabbergasted by this. Anyway, thank you so much for the show, guys.
And what a nice guy. On top of it all, what a nice guy.
And we stole him from the States. He's ours.
Yeah. I wonder if he's an actual citizen now, or if he's... Still.
If he's not, we'll have to change that.
Yeah. Exactly. Like, you have to renounce America. No, we're joking. We're totally joking.
He'd be naturalized. Yeah, I think he'd be naturalized by now.
The nice thing about Canada, guys, is you can be both American and Canadian at the exact same time.
We have stronger beer.
We do. And better whiskey.
Thank you so much for joining us on the show today, guys. You can follow us on leftofthevalley.com. You can follow us on Facebook, on Twitter, at LETV Podcast. Send us an email at leftatvalley@outlook.com. And you can also follow us, our little sister show from our friend Tyler, So You Think You're a Skeptic, on Facebook. I always forget to say that. So
then they're like, where the hell is the show?
It's on Facebook. Coming up next week, we'll do something a bit more low-key. We'll be talking about our own personal apostasy. That should be fun. Just a conversation between us.
And 5 hours later.
Exactly.
We're done. Kristina's story.
And December comes around, and we'll also be talking to the folks at Politico's, our friend Ian Bush.
Yeah, coming back. Politics.
And also all the good work she does for BC Humanist. On the 16th, for our last interview of the year, we have Thomas Smith.
Be still my beating heart.
We'll be coming on the show and talking to us about all the crazy stuff that goes on in the States. And of course, for the end of the year, we'll also have our Christmas special and our best, top 10 best of the year for the 2017.
It's going to be a fun month, and however many weeks are left in November.
Exactly.
Oh, and by the way, everybody, read Harry Potter.
Oh, jeez.
or the new History of Magic book that is illustrated. It's amazing.
You cannot promote magic on an atheist show.
It's so beautiful.
No, you can't do that.
It's a Harry Potter textbook.
I don't care.
It's fantasy.
It's fantasy, yes. It's gorgeous, though.
You have to make that disclaimer right at the beginning. This is fantasy.
Or is it?
You're on mute. You've been muted.
Very easily, he controls the buttons.
I have God in the show. Thank you, guys. Until next time. Now let me take a sec on me that sounds so hateful, but I swear to God, pun intended, I find it disgraceful that thousands of children are raped by priests, and since they're holy men of God, they get away scot-free. Does his very best to keep it on the hush. Don't wanna affect business, he loves money too much. We know that they love the kids, but how the fuck can we protect them while they planning to molest them? We teaching them to respect them. Respect them? Fuck that. The system is broke down, working backwards, and the only action or tactic I plan to practice now is to attack them. The parties of God's hands are bloodstained. Millions of murders by believers, and they're all in God's name. And let me take a sec, don't mean to sound so hateful, but I swear to God, pun intended, I find it disgraceful that many atheists are told to be quiet. You're not alone, speak your mind, time to let it be known. I'm proud to be an atheist, a skeptic, a non-believer, an infidel, a heathen, I call it how I see it. I say it's ignorance and you just call it faith, and unsubstantiated claims, that's something to be ashamed.